So we're going to talk about space-filling curves. So already that sounds sort of counterintuitive, like a curve is like a one, like it's a very skinny one-dimensional thing, but space is like two-dimensional or something. So how can you have a curve that fills up everything in space? So we're going to build a curve, starting with something very simple, and then we're going to sort of change it. So let's start with this curve here. So this is three sides of a square. So at the moment, this is really not very space filling, right? It's just three lines. So we need to kind of make it more squiggly and we'll get there. So let's draw a grid on this. So like four squares. And so my curve is like going through the centers of those squares. So what we're going to do to make this red curve more squiggly is divide each of these squares into four. So like chop it up. We want to make a more squiggly version of this, but we're going to use this same shape. So here's how you do it. You sort of have to rotate it a little bit to make it work. So there's the same shape, but I've rotated it. And then we'll do one like that, another one like that, and one like this. And then we need to connect them up. So let's connect them up like this, and like this, and like this. And you can see this is maybe slightly more space filling, like it's getting more places than this one was, and it's sort of made of the same stuff. So, well, let's do another one, why not? And then in each one of these squares, I need to put this thing here, so let me make a grid. And then I just have to turn things the right way again. So I want to take this thing and rotate it and put it here. So it's going to start like that. And it's going to end like that. And in the middle, it's going to do this, and it's going to do this. And let's connect them up with red, because, okay, so we got that shape. And then this one over here, let's do this one next, because it's easy, because it's just, right, it's just the reflection of this one. Connect them up, boop, boop, boop. And then these, I'm getting good at this now. So this is going to be like that. Connect up, connect up, connect up. Okay, and then again, we connect up in the same way, we do a course like that, and like that, and like that. And we've got something that's more squiggly, more sort of space filling. And you can see how like you would just continue doing this. So this is the Hilbert curve. So this was invented by, or discovered by David Hilbert in 1891. Really, these are like steps in the construction of it. The Hilbert curve is when you do this infinitely many times.
You're using a Sharpie, which has thickness to it.
Right.
But surely a theoretical line has no thickness.
Yeah, zero thickness.
So if something has zero thickness, right, how can it fill any space?
Well, right, every step, the thing that you have has no thickness, is filling nothing. But somehow when you go infinitely far, well, actually what happens is that in a rigorous way, which I'm not gonna get into, but actually what happens when you go infinitely far, this curve hits every point of the square. So somehow at the limit, when you get infinitely far, boom, you've got everything. This construction is not just used for this sort of infinite thing. This is also a way to sort of pack sort of two-dimensional data in a one-dimensional order, right? So suppose you have a bunch of two-dimensional data that you need to store for some reason, and you need to store it in some linear order, but you also want this bit of data and this bit of data, they're quite close to each other in two dimensions, and you would like them to be close to each other in the ordering. And the Hilbert curve kind of gives you a way of often two points that are close together in two dimensions are also close together in the linear order, right? And whereas if you did like, you know, just sort of, if you just ordered it by rows, then that's sort of less likely to be true. Anyway, so it's important in computer science. I think there's even some theories that the way that DNA is packed up when it's wrapped up in the chromosome is sort of like this. But anyway, so what I was interested in was this sequence of curves, like the sequence of polygons, how you get there. And so you can think of this like as an animation, going from one to the next, and so on through time. Or you could think of this as space rather than time. So there we go. This is a 3D printed sculpture that shows this construction. At the very top, you've got the original curve. And then, well, so you can see there's like a band here. That's just a sort of intermediate band. But then the next band down, so two down, is the next step of the sequence. It's probably a little hard to see, but it starts here, and then it goes across, and then up, and then back, and then it goes up, and it does that curve that we had before. And then it just keeps going down, so another two steps and another two steps. So there's the bottom. That's quite far along in the, let's see how many, this is, so the first step, second step, third step, fourth, this is the fifth step of that sequence. And I mean, in principle, I could just keep going, right? But it gets very thin and difficult to print. So this is one of many space-filling curves or fractal curves. So so there's one called the dragon curve.
Oh, another one.
Yeah, oh right, you did one on this.
Lots, way more than you can fold a bit of paper. You get this rather stunning pattern.
And it keeps going, but in the middle it gets very intricate.
So how does the dragon curve one? So here's the first one, you just have a straight line. And then the next level down, there's just a like a right angle corner. And then the next one down, this one, every band is another step of the dragon curve sequence. And then at the bottom you got your dragon curve. So this is like, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9. I think this is 9 iterations of the dragon curve. But right, when you sort of extrude it through space, you get this cool shape. Somebody once described this to me as a skyscraper going for a walk. It's sort of a nice image. Recognize this shape? That would be the Sierpinski triangle, except there's a curve called the Sierpinski arrowhead curve. Let's turn it around. So it starts with, again, this is smoothed off a little bit, but it starts with 3 sides of a hexagon, and then, well, it gets more squiggly. But yeah, you end up with something that looks like the Sierpinski triangle. I wanted to show you the clone troopers. So you'd make all of this, like this is just math, right? I mean, there's just this simple sequence. But then once you've made it, and you see the faces, the eyes and the noses and the mouth here, at least, I don't know, maybe you've blanked your mind of all references of the prequels, but Clone Troopers is what this said to me. So in the other room, there's one based on something called the Ter-Dragon Curve. It's like the Dragon Curve, but there's a 3 in it. There's a slightly different process that does it. And yeah, this is a really big one that we dyed in a very large trash can. So final thing, this is sort of a 3-dimensional version of the 2-dimensional Hilbert curve. So this is sort of 3-dimensional versions of a lot of these. This is the third step, right? So rather than showing the whole sequence sort of as an extruded animation, this is just the third step of that sequence. And you get this very squiggly curve that is filling 3-dimensional space or a 3-dimensional cube. So one of the sort of really interesting things about this is like, so I'd seen this thing for like, I don't know, a year or two sitting on my computer screen as this rigid, perfect mathematical object. And then, so, you know, I order it and I take it out of the box and it's springy. And I had no idea it was gonna do that. It's incredibly springy. Like you can even wear it as a kind of uncomfortable bracelet. But yeah, this, well, and you can see that it's a curve, right? It's just a single loop in space that forms itself back into a cube.
And you were surprised by that?
Yeah, no, like, I mean, I guess I could have predicted it maybe that, because it's just, you know, there's no interconnections. So it's just this sort of like single loop. It should be flexible, but I just never thought of it that way. And then it was, you know, having the physical thing. There's, I mean, you can't not notice that it's all springy.
If you enjoy Henry's videos here on Numberphile, then you're really going to love his new book about visualizing mathematics with 3D printing. I'll put some information about it in the video description. And while you're in the video description, why not check out the list of people who support us on Patreon? Our thanks to them for helping out. But seriously, check out that book. It's got some mind-blowing stuff in it. And it's also a really good way to show your support for Henry, who helps us out here on Numberphile.